Welcome to today's webcast, The Vital Signs for Procurement, Diagnosing Results of the Pulse of Procurement 2014 Market Study. My name is Richard Waugh. I'm Vice President of Corporate Development for Zycus, and I'll be your host for today's webcast to share with you a number of the insights that we've been able to glean through this Pulse of Procurement study. And first, what I wanted to do is actually share with you a little bit of the background on the study itself, some of the demographics. So we've actually surveyed greater than 300 respondents and conducted this survey over the course of about 2 months, December of 2013 and January of this year. And when you look at the respondents, to a large extent, large enterprises are extremely well represented here. So 80% of the respondents actually have revenues in excess of $500 million. The other key demographic here is that predominantly, they're North American headquartered organizations, although with revenues of that magnitude, certainly most are global or multinational organizations, but three-quarters have their headquarters based in North America, then the remaining 25% in other parts of the globe. First, I wanted to look at some of the key trends and existing persistent and chronic pain points that we diagnosed in this study across the procurement organization surveyed. We did see some incremental or marginal gains in what we'll call the strategic procurement maturity matrix here. So you see the top tiers, about 5% say that they've already achieved global best in class, and you know, about a third more have been able to identify that their procurement function has systematically been delivering wins, whereas the remainder still are starting to just begin delivering those early wins or either see themselves as gaining momentum or trying to extend influence over new categories of spend or across the organization's stakeholders. So a slight gain, about 1 percentage point from our prior study, in the top two tiers, those that are systematically delivering wins or have achieved best-in-class status already. One area that we saw greater strides as compared to our earlier study is in the measure of spend under management, which is a key benchmark for how well procurement is extending its influence across the organization, bringing more spend under centralized control. And in that area, organizations that are reporting greater than 60% of total spend under management, that's risen by 6% from the 2011 study to the point where today more than half now occupy those top two spend under management tiers, more than half with greater than 60% spend under management, and about 13% at greater than 80% total spending under management. So a healthy vital sign there for the future of procurement and the influence and extent to which it is able to control spending. We talked about savings too, and in this regard, cumulative savings. So we asked organizations, since they've implemented a centralized, focused strategic procurement process, how much have they been able to capture in the area of cumulative savings? And you can see that there, at the top end, there's a minority, but about 27%, that have captured greater than 20% cumulative savings, but still a significant portion that haven't yet cracked the 10% mark in cumulative savings, about a third, and another 10% that still struggle to get beyond a 5% savings figure. One area that did see a much bigger jump was overall contract compliance rates. So whereas that number back in 2011 hovered below 50%, actually about 41% compliant spending, which of course means the inverse of that is a maverick spending, at about 59%. This year, or this version of the study, showed a 14% increase in overall the weighted average contract compliance rate up to about 55%, and a significant portion that are better than 60% in overall contract compliance rates. Now, when we probed further for where the pain still exists with the respondents, some issues really came to the core, to the fore, in this case, data quality being the most persistent and chronic pain issue, really, especially as regards internal information quality, 47%, but also external market data and the quality of information that they're able to integrate still being a big issue. The ability to then track and measure performance and having the management systems in place, still being thwarted to some extent by overall corporate organization, governance, and culture, and technology adoption still lagging behind what the expectation was. Somewhat lesser pain and contract compliance, and of course we saw that there's been significant gains in the compliance rate, so that would certainly explain some of that. But you know, at the top, really issues about data quality. So next we're going to look at what are some of the key results from our survey as regards technology investment, areas where organizations have already invested, where they plan to make future investments in technology. And when we look across the whole source-to-pay continuum and looked at current investments, not surprising that spend analytics, for instance, about 70% had already invested. That's been the foundational level to drive procurement transformations as a best practice for a long time. Perhaps a little bit surprising that contract management comes in at the second most adopted, about almost two-thirds of organizations having implemented contract management. And again, that certainly explains why those compliance rates went up as much as they did. Somewhat surprising that traditionally hard dollar ROI solutions like e-sourcing, like procure-to-pay, didn't come in higher than they did, but still they're in the camp that are at 50% penetration or better, with only supplier management or the procurement performance and process management tools, the only ones below a 50% current adoption rate. Interesting, though, when we contrast that, we ask the respondents to tell us what their future investment plans are. The picture becomes flipped, almost completely inverted, to where those with the lowest current adoption are the ones that are targeted for investment dollars in the future, to put more emphasis behind supplier management tools, behind procurement process management tools like financial savings tracking and management, for example, which is actually the highest at about 35% plan to invest in those tools. So overall, the trend that we see in the future is having put in place a number of the foundational components of a technology infrastructure for procurement, which tend to be slightly more transactional, either spend transactions or even contracts or RFXs or POs in the procure-to-pay space, the focus then becomes more on the process and analytics involved with strategic process and supplier performance management, as well as performance of the procurement organization itself. So next we looked at what the current state of that technology configuration is, and again, a little bit then about the future state. Here we see that there's the current situation reflects the vast majority of organizations, about two-thirds, are either having to make do with the homegrown or legacy system or the incumbent ERP system, but when it comes to their future plan, when we ask them about the expected future state, that picture again becomes completely inverted to the point where about the same number, two-thirds, they were no longer going to be content with a legacy system or kind of a generic ERP system with tools that aren't specifically configured for procurement. Instead, we're going to focus on procurement-specific solutions, about 30%, and an even greater number, about 32%, that want, in fact, an entirely integrated procurement-specific suite of tools as their preferred technology configuration. We also then looked at how that technology infrastructure, that configuration of what types of tools they're using, correlates to their overall performance with regard to savings. So when we looked at, for instance, the lowest tier of cumulative savings, those less than 5%, they actually had the greatest preponderance of that configuration of either a homegrown or ERP system, about 80% today. However, when we asked them where they plan to go in the future, while the ERP holds constant at about 30%, legacy diminishes greatly. They're clearly moving away from that to where there would only be 10% still with a legacy type platform, and more either a procurement specific mix or an integrated suite of procurement tools, to the point where about 50% overall would be using in the future procurement specific tools. An even greater percentage than when we look at those with the highest cumulative savings, those greater than 20%. In that group, there's already a significant proportion that are using a full suite, about 35%, and more will be moving away from the point to where the homegrown or legacy systems almost vanish entirely, and ERP is somewhat fixed, but the mix clearly moving towards procurement-focused solutions to continually drive those higher savings and greater performance levels. Next, we looked at, well, what does this really mean? What's the impact of the technology adoption on the organization itself? And first looked at how technology adoption sort of ripples across the organization, not just within the procurement group, the core procurement, but distributed procurement users and, in fact, end users and stakeholders across the business. And it's interesting that adoption rates trend upward as we go into the higher savings tiers. So 63%, for instance, enterprise procurement users actively engaged adopting the technology platforms that they've deployed. But that's simply a marginally higher than the lower savings tiers. But when you look at the distributed procurement personnel, so buyers out in the plants and those kinds of users, that's much higher, and still higher yet the incidence of end-user stakeholder adoption. So two times higher at 48% for the highest savings performers versus the lowest at 24%. So a key success factor being not just getting procurement users on board, but getting the end-user stakeholders engaged and collaborating with the procurement users to really drive organization-wide adoption. We also asked respondents to kind of tell us what's the optimal mix of features in the tool set, and we saw across the board the highest adoption levels when there was a focus on utilizing standard features, to some extent reflecting the fact that the more complex a technology becomes with a lot of advanced features can actually create a barrier to adoption, an inhibitor. Whereas having the right mix of easy-to-use standard features can actually drive the highest organization-wide impact of the tools. The other thing we measured was how does technology impact overall cycle time efficiencies across a couple of dimensions. The first one being the sourcing process before and after the introduction of e-sourcing technologies. And we also compared simpler categories, sort of the three bids and a buy approach to sourcing, to more complex categories that would involve longer cycle time, more evaluative and analytical processes. And it was an interesting dichotomy here, whereas there was much greater cycle time compression for simpler categories, going from about 8 weeks to about 5 weeks to actually complete those negotiation processes. Whereas the cycle time reduction was actually significantly smaller when it came to the complex categories, only about 7%, and that seemed counterintuitive. After all, the benefit of automation to speed up the RFP creation and bid collection and aggregation should be shared equally between simple and complex categories, if not even greater for those more complex and larger bid packages. But when we dug a little bit deeper, what we really found is, in fact, that automation benefit on the front end really does apply to the complex categories as well, but the behavior that this enabled was for organizations to actually be more deliberative on the back end analysis and optimization process. So having spent less time preparing larger, more complex bid packages and aggregating the much larger amounts of data involved with those quotes, they're then able to spend, in fact, more time running multiple what-if scenarios where the dollars at stake are much larger. Likewise, we also looked at cycle time performance on the operational procurement side, so procure to pay, before and after the introduction of a P2P or e-procurement technology, and once again contrasted between simpler and more complex categories. Simple categories, a dramatic cycle time reduction, about 40%, from about 6 days to about 3 days to get from a requisition to an approved purchase order out to the supplier. Somewhat smaller, but still a cycle time improvement when it comes to more complex categories. So not something involving, for instance, a non-catalog requisition, something that's not a standard commodity product that fits in a catalog model that goes through a longer order cycle time process, but still a significant cycle time efficiency benefit. So the other thing we wanted to do is kind of ask some more open-ended questions of our survey respondents about what are your future expectations. We've looked at the current state. We've seen some significant improvements. We've seen higher technology adoption and a clear trend towards more focused and specialized procurement applications. So what do they expect to get out of those future investments and plans for the future? And when we asked respondents to look 5 years out, the first thing they told us, the most resoundingly, was they want process integration across all those internal processes. That, you know, the sourcing process can't be separate from the operational procurement process, that spend analytics flows into sourcing, and there's a continuous process where they want data to flow seamlessly across. Not only that, they want it to be more forward-looking and predictive, so less about how do we spend money in the past or how do we even perform in the past, and how can we predict where our spending patterns are going, try to identify supplier performance trends and avoid things like a supply risk, supply chain disruptions, or other type of failures, and to a greater extent, really get a full 360 view of what's going on by integrating internal data analytics with external market intelligence to bring that more forward-looking and predictive view to pass. So anecdotally, we asked the respondents to kind of articulate what that vision looks like to them. Some of the same themes emerged: tight integration, analytics utilizing big data, all the modules integrated seamlessly, and one-click metrics and dashboard to drill into spend by supplier and track performance, and really be able to have that single tool or technology platform that's truly integrated. So those are the key trends and clearly the vision that our survey respondents have for the future of procurement and the pulse of procurement going forward. So I really want to thank you for your time today. I've enjoyed having the chance to share with you the Pulse of Procurement study results, the full copy of which is available at our website. I invite you to visit our website there, download the report. I think you'll find a lot of great vital signs to help you benchmark your own performance internally and to look ahead to where best practice is leading and what state of the art is. Thanks very much for your time today.